before so piquant a spectacle, France, it seemed, could have no time nor attention for the revelation of Monsieur Humbert, the reporter of the Army Committee, proclaiming that the artillery was short of ammunition, that her infantry had boots 30 years old, and not enough of those. Such were the appearances of things. Can it be wondered if it seemed to the German mind that the moment for the triumphant assertion of the German predominance in the world had come? A day or so before the Dublin shooting, the murder of Sarajevo had been dragged again into the foreground of the world's affairs by an ultimatum from Austria to Serbia of the extremest violence. From the hour when the ultimatum was discharged, the way to Armageddon lay wide and unavoidable before the feet of Europe. After the Dublin conflict, there was no turning back. For a week, Europe was occupied by proceedings that were little more than the recital of a formula. Austria could not withdraw her unqualified threats without admitting error and defeat. Russia could not desert Serbia without disgrace. Germany stood behind Austria. France was bound to Russia by a long confederacy of mutual support, and it was impossible for England to witness the destruction of France, or the further strengthening of a loud and threatening rival. It may be that Germany counted on Russia giving way to her. It may be she counted on the indecisions and feeble perplexities of England. Both these possibilities were in the reckoning. But chiefly, she counted on war. She counted on war, and since no nation in all the world had ever been so fully prepared in every way for war as she was, she also counted on victory. One writes Germany.